In my lab, we're developing a brain-computer interface technique that's designed to tweak the brain in a way that may improve self-controllability. So I thought I'd begin with one example of successful self-control and one example of failed self-control. We'll start with self-control failure here. And in this clip, the boy is doing something called the Marshmallow Test, which involves leaving a kid in a room for 15 minutes alone with one marshmallow. The kid's task? Don't eat the marshmallow. And this clip takes place just after the experimenter leaves the room. Okay. This next clip is an example of self-control success, and this is actually a home movie.
Sit. Now wait.
So we're all familiar with the need for self-control in everyday decision-making. We have to choose between saving and spending, between the gym and the couch, between carrots and cookies. And these decisions, the ability to exhibit self-control when you're making these kinds of decisions, can have very important consequences. Kids who have poor self-control go on to be adults who are more likely to commit crimes and to have financial problems. They don't play well with others, and they don't cope well with stress. And kids with poor self-control are more likely to grow up to be obese and to have many other health problems. And when you give a child a self-control test like this marshmallow task, something happens in the brain. And as a result of what happens in the brain, the kid either successfully resists temptation or fails to do so. Now, the evidence suggests that this kid who resists the marshmallow may grow up to be a healthy, wealthy, educated, socially competent, well-adjusted adult, while this kid who ate the marshmallow may end up, you know, an unhealthy, uneducated, delinquent, socially incompetent inmate. So if we can move people along this top row more and this bottom path less, that seems like a good thing. My interest as a researcher, what's going on here at the level of the brain that we might be able to intervene on in order to improve self-controllability? Of course, for that to work, we need to know a little bit about the neural mechanisms underlying self-control. What's going on in the brain when someone chooses carrots over cookies? And that used to be a black box. Fortunately, researchers have recently opened that black box. So we now know a little bit about what's happening in the brain when somebody resists the marshmallow. And because we know something about what's happening in the brain when somebody exhibits self-control, we may be able to actually intervene on those neural mechanisms to improve self-controllability. So we've been working for several years on a technique to do that, and it's called strides. Self-control training for increasing delay of gratification through EEG biofeedback with source localization, and you can see why we needed an acronym. And here's how it works. This is a representation of our brain-computer interface paradigm. And this region that's kind of glowing here is very important for self-control. As you can see, when that region lights up, the bar in the top panel goes up. When that region is not lighting up, bar goes down. Okay, so brain and bar are linked. What we do is we bring people into our lab, and we hook them up to an EEG machine, so they've got electrodes all over the scalp. We use that to monitor brain activity in the region shown, as well as other regions. And then we show people that bar in front of them on a monitor going up and down. So they're getting information about what's happening in their own brain in real time. And then we say to people, make the bar go up. So notice what's going on in your mind. What are you thinking? What are you feeling when the bar goes up? And whatever it is that makes the bar go up, do more of that. And through trial and error and operant conditioning, people learn to do it. Now, when they're learning to make the bar go up, they're really learning to make that region of the brain light up. And if they're better at making that brain region light up, they may have better self-controllability. We recently finished a study of this approach, and these are the most important results. Blue line represents change over time in self-control performance for a control condition. Red line is change over time in self-control performance for the strides group, the group that did this brain-computer interface training. And as you can see, for the control group, self-control plummets as time goes on. And that wasn't unexpected. That's observed in the literature more often than not. For the strides group, on the other hand, the group that did this treatment, self-control did not decrease over time. And what that suggests is that this brain-computer interface kind of training may be useful for preventing the erosion over time in self-control performance that's typically observed in the literature. Now, we used to think of self-control as, you know, an angel on one shoulder, devil on the other shoulder. The two battle it out, and that's what determines behavior. But we now know self-control doesn't look like that. Self-control looks like that. So self-control is not a magical, metaphysical phenomenon. Self-control is a tangible, physiological process that we should be able to intervene on. Many people believe that self-control is fixed, that you're born with a certain level of self-control. There's not much you can do to change that. And before we knew much about self-control, that was probably true, but we're learning more and more, and self-control is becoming more malleable. And I suspect that we'll soon have widespread access to technologies like this that will allow people to exercise the neural mechanisms underlying self-control in a manner that's very similar to how you might exercise a muscle. And that's going to allow people to transcend the limitations of their innate levels of self-control.